فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. We are in the explanation of the kitab At-Tibyaan في آداب حملة القرآن, written by الإمام العلامة المجتهد محي الدين أبي زكريا يحيى بن شرف النووي. We are in the sixth chapter, فصل في البكاء عند قراءة القرآن. The author says,
The author رحمه الله says, قد تقدم في الفصلين المتقدمين بيان ما يحمل على البكاء في حال القراءة وهو صفة العارفين وشعار عباد الله الصالحين. قال الله تعالى ويخرون للأذقان يبكون ويزيدهم خشوعا. وقد وردت فيه أحاديث وأخبار وآثار عن السلف كثيرة. فمن ذلك عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: اقرأوا القرآن وابكوا فإن لم تبكوا فتباكوا. وعن عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه أنه صلى بالجماعة الصبح فقرأ سورة يوسف فبكى حتى سالت دموعه عن ترقواته. وفي رواية أنه كان في صلاة العشاء فيدل على تكرره من. وفي رواية بكى حتى سمعوا بكاءه من وراء الصفوف. وعن أبي رجاء قال: رأيت ابن عباس رضي الله عنه وتحت عينيه مثل شراك البالي من الدموع. وعن أبي صالح قال: قدم ناس من أهل اليمن على أبي بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه فجعلوا يقرؤونهم القرآن ويبكون. فقال أبو بكر رضي الله عنه: هكذا كنا. وعن هشام قال: ربما سمعت بكاء محمد بن سيرين في الليل وهو في الصلاة، والآثار في هذا كثيرة لا يمكن حصرها. وفيها أشرنا إليه ونبهنا عليه كفاية والله أعلم. قال الإمام أبو حامد الغزالي: البكاء مستحب مع القراءة وعندها. قال: وطريقه في تحصيله أن يحضر قلبه الحزن بأن يتأمل ما فيه من التهديد والوعيد الشديد والوثائق والعهود، ثم يتأمل تقصيره في ذلك. فإن لم يحضر حزن وبكاء كما يحضر الخواص فليبكي على فقد ذلك، فإنه من أعظم المصائب. In the previous two sections, we have mentioned that which leads a reciter to weep while reciting.
The author here, he speaks about a topic called crying and weeping when reading the Quran. He said in the two previous chapters, we've clarified and we explained those who, due to their reading of the Quran, it led them to weeping. And he goes on to say,
such weeping is an attribute of those who know and appreciate Allah's greatness, and is a symbol of the righteous slaves of Allah.
The author here, he says, Imam al-Nawawi, that crying is sifatul arifin. It is the characteristics and the attributes of those who know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَشِعَارُ عِبَادِ اللَّهِ الصَّالِحِينَ. And it is also the symbol of the righteous slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Allah says, and they fall upon their faces weeping, and it increases them in fear and humility toward Allah.
Allah said in this verse, وَيَخِرُّونَ لِلْأَذْقَانِ يَبُكُونَ وَيَزِيدُهُمْ خُشُوعًا. وَيَخِرُّونَ لِلْأَذْقَانِ. They fall in humiliation, in humility, state of humility. يَبْكُونَ. They cry. وَيَزِيدُهُمْ. And it increases them in what? Al-khushu'.
Much has been narrated of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the pious predecessors with regard to this matter. For instance, it is narrated that the Messenger, peace be upon him, said, recite the Quran and weep. And if you are unable to weep, then try to weep.
The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this hadith that was narrated, some scholars have spoken about its authenticity, that the Messenger said, اقرأوا القرآن, and read the Quran. وَبْكُوا, and cry. فَإِن لَمْ تَبْكَوْا, if you're not able to cry, فَتَبَاكَوْا, make yourself cry. Bring yourself to tears. Now.
It is reported that Umar ibn al-Khattab led the morning congregational prayers and recited Surah to Yusuf and cried until his tears wet his collarbone. In another narration, it is
Umar radiallahu anhu, Amir al-Mu'mineen, a man who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him strength, Allah gave him power. He was a very, very strong individual, character-wise. Physically, Umar radiallahu anhu was a very strong man. He was strong enough, they said, that if he sat on a horse, his legs would touch the floor. Umar was very strong. He would make a horse seem as though it was a donkey. The height and the strength that Umar carried, and the iman that Umar had, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the certainty and the yaqeen. Ma'adhalika Umar, he led Salatul Subh, Fajr prayer. فَقَرَأَ, he recited Surah to Yusuf. فَبَكَأَ, he cried, حَتَّى ثَالَتْ دُمُوعُهُ, until his tears gushed from him. And it flew دُمُوعُهُ عَلَى تَرْقُوَتِهِ, until it came to his collarbones. Like the hadith of Prophet ﷺ, he said about the Khawarij, لَا يُجَاوِزُ تَرَاقِيَهُمْ. تَرَاقِيَ means the collarbone. So his tears watered, it came out of his eyes, and it flew, it moved so much that it filled his collarbone. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And remember, my beloved brothers and sisters, he was an individual who, whilst he was walking on this earth, and he knew he was in his dunya, he knew he had a place in Jannah. And he was assured that. So you find those who don't know if they're going to go to Jannah, and they haven't even been informed if they're righteous enough to earn a place in Jannah. Ma'adhalik, and even then they are what? They are in a state of heedlessness.
In another narration, it is said that this happens during the Isha prayers, which suggests that it happens more than once. In yet another narration,
some said Fajr, some said Isha. All of this shows in different situations Umar used to cry. فَيَدُلُّ عَلَى تَكَرُّرِهِ مِنْهُ. It shows that all of this, it came from Umar on many different occasions.
In yet another narration, it is said that he cried until he was heard from behind the prayer rows.
That Umar رضي الله عنه, another riwayah says, بَكَى حَتَّى سَمِعُ بُكَاءَهُ مِنْ وَرَاءِ الصُّفُوفِ. That the people, there's no microphone here that picks up your tears and your crying. So his crying was picked up, it could be heard at the ending of the lines. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu, say that he was crying loud.
Abu Raja'a reports, I looked at Ibn Abbas once and saw that there was a line like a shoelace under his eyes from his tears.
Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abi Raja'a, he said, I saw Ibn Abbas's face. And when I looked at his face, and I saw وَتَحْتَ عَيْنَيْهِ, beneath his eyes, on his cheeks, مِثْلُ شِرَاكِ الْبَالِي, it was like shoelaces. There were lines on his face, Ibn Abbas. Min ad-dumu'i, due to his tears. The tears are, what do you call it, salty. So if it comes on your face too much, it does change the color of your face. Naam.
Abu Saleh narrated that a group of men came to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq from Yemen, and that they began to recite the Quran and weep. And Abu Bakr said, "This is how we used to be," meaning, "This is how we would also be affected by the recitation of the Quran."
Abu Saleh, he said, "Qadima nasu min ahli Yemen." A group of people came from Yemen, and they came to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and they read the Quran on him. Amongst themselves, they started to read the Quran and they started to cry. They couldn't hold themselves back. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he said, "Hakada kunna." This is what we also were. Ama, this is how we are when we read the Quran. It affects us. Naam.
Hisham said, "At times I would hear the weeping of Muhammad ibn Sirin in the night while he prayed. There are countless other stories narrated regarding our predecessors on this topic, but what we have mentioned so far and drawn attention to is sufficient, and Allah knows best."
He says, Hisham, he said, "Rubbama," it's possible. "Sami'tu buka'a Muhammad ibn Sirin," I would hear the crying and the weeping of who? Muhammad ibn Sirin, the great tabi'i. "Fi layli," at night. "Wa huwa fi salati," whilst he was in the prayer. So you hear that these imams, they also were, they had tazkiyah. Hubbu sunnah wa qam'u al-bid'ah. Spreading the sunnah and destroying innovation was what Muhammad ibn Sirin was known for. He was harsh with innovation. And he was hard with innovators. He loved the sunnah and the prevailing of the sunnah. Alayhi rahmatullah. Ma'a thalika, even then, these are attributes and characteristics of the people of the sunnah. That they were very close with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Quran. And they would cry at night whilst in prayer. Naam.
Imam Abu Hamid al-Ghazali said...
Abu? What did he say?
Abu Hamid al-Ghazali.
Did he not say Abu Hamid?
Imam Abu Hamid al-Ghazali stated that weeping is recommended when reciting the Quran.
So Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, he says in his kitab Ihya' Ulumuddin, now he transmits it from him. He says, "Al-buka' mustahabbun ma'al qira'ati wa 'indaha," that it is recommended to cry when reading the Quran, recommended. Now Abu Hamid al-Ghazali is going to mention, how can you attain crying? Ayah?
He added that the way of achieving that is by creating sadness in the heart through contemplation and contemplating the stern warnings in the Quran.
So what it means, the way to attain that crying is, and يُحْذَرَ قَلْبَهُ الْحُزْنَ, that you bring sadness to your heart. So you get, don't joke, don't laugh, don't play, think. How can you bring sadness to your heart? The way you can is, he says, بِأَنْ يَتَأَمَّلَ مَا فِيهِ مِنَ التَّهْدِيدِ وَالْوَعِيدِ الشَّدِيدِ, that you ponder and you really think about the severe warnings that are in the Qur'an, you see, and the punishments that Allah mentions in the Qur'an. Naam.
And that which Allah has prepared as punishments.
And also the person keeps in mind the things that Allah has prepared as punishments. He keeps that in mind as well. And he also ponders on that as well. Yeah?
And then to recall the pledges and the oaths one has broken, thereby deserving such punishments.
Then the person, what he does is that, ثُمَّ يَتَأَمَّلُ تَقْصِيرَهُ, that the person starts thinking about how he has become extremely negligent in the matters of, or he has become short in regards to those warnings and those punishments, that he has fallen into those things, and that he has broken the punishment, he's broken the promises with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He thinks so and he remembers that. Naam.
If one is unable to weep for this, as the pious ones did.
So if after all of that,
you feel like you're still unable to weep. فَإِنْ لَمْ يَحْضُرْهُ حُزْنٌ. If sadness doesn't cover you then, وَبُكَاءٌ, and you don't cry because of, and you don't cry after thinking like that. كَمَا يَحْضُرُهُ الْخَوَّاسُ. As the elite people, the righteous people, the noble ones, they feel, then he said, فَلْيَبْكِ عَلَى فَقْدِ ذَلِكَ فَإِنَّهُ مِنْ أَعْظَمِ الْمَصَائِبِ. نعم.
He should weep due to his inability to weep, as this is indeed one of the greatest calamities.
So you should actually cry because you can't cry. For verily, what you're in, my beloved brothers and sisters, is a very serious illness. And you need to, my beloved brothers and sisters, if you feel that way, you should definitely go to a doctor. And the doctor here is a scholar and a person of ilm. Because your heart is something to be worried for. And as you know, my beloved brothers and sisters, Maymun ibn Mihran kana katiban li Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. Maymun ibn Mihran was a writer for who? He was a writer for Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. He used to write for him. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was known. أنه كان لا يقرب إلا الأفاضل. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was very well known that he wouldn't bring no one close to himself except the righteous people. The only person who can come close to Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was a noble person. Are you with me? Yeah? The only person who can come close to him is a righteous and a noble individual. So what happened was, Maymun ibn Mihran, from the narration it seemed like he lost his eyesight. So he told his son, my son, take me to who? Hassan al-Basri. Take me to him, and I want to sit with him, and inshallah ta'ala I need to talk to him. So his son took him by the hand, he took Maymun ibn Mihran by the hand, and he took Maymun ibn Mihran to what you call Hassan al-Basri. Maymun ibn Mihran, when he came to Hassan al-Basri, the door of his house, he knocked. When he knocked the door, the slave girl of Maymun ibn Mihran's house, she said, who's at the door? And then he responded by saying, Maymun ibn Mihran said, it is me, Maymun. And so she said to him, يا شيخ السوء بأبقاك في هذا الزمن السوء. Evil Shaykh, what made you remain at this evil time? Why are you alive at this time for? It's an evil time. So he cried so much, Maymun, so much so that it brought Hassan al-Basri out of his inner chamber that he was praying in. When he came out, he grabbed Maymun by the hand and he brought him into the house and he sat him down and he said, what brought you to me? And so he said to him, Maymun ibn Mihran said that my heart has become hard. My heart has become hard. So what shall I do for it? What shall I do to it? And then Maymun Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah, he was very well known for how his speech was and how he spoke and the words that he could say to a person make them really think, really think. To this extent that Dhahabi rahimahullah said it was as though Hassan al-Basri dhahaba ila al-akhirati wa ayyanaha. He went to the Day of Judgment, he saw the akhirah, he saw everything, he came back to tell the people about it. This is how he was, Hassan al-Basri. But look what he did. He looked at Maymun ibn Mihran and he said to him, he recited the verses on him, afara'ayta in matta'nahum sinin. ثم جاءهم ما كانوا يوعدون ما أغنى عنهم ما كانوا يمتعون. أفرأيت إن متعناهم سنين. Allah says, do you see that if we give them a joy, متعناهم سنين, very short time, we let them enjoy themselves for a period of time, we allow them to enjoy themselves. ثم, and after that Allah says, ثم جاءهم ما كانوا يوعدون. And then Allah says, we bring to them what we have promised them, the punishment that we promise to them, we'll bring them. We let you enjoy yourself for a period of time, and then we bring you the punishment that we have promised you. Yeah? ثُمَّ جَاءَهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يُعَدُونَ. Allah says, مَا أَغْنَى عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يُمَتَّعُونَ. The joy that you had will not suffice you from the punishment. It will not suffice you. So Maymun ibn Mihran stood up and he left Hassan al-Basri's gathering. His son on the way, he said, "Father, that was Hassan al-Basri, right?" He said, "Yes, it was." He said, "We didn't say much." And Hassan al-Basri was known for his kalam. He only read ayat like that. And he said to him, "My son, Hassan al-Basri spoke verses, words, that the person whose heart is alive will feel what he said." But what I want from this story is that Maymun ibn Mihran, when he felt that his heart wasn't as it was, well, who did he go to? Huh? He went to the alim. And the Sahabas, when they felt that way, who did they run to? The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And you guys know the famous hadith, Nafaqa Hantala. When the Hantala radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam and he said, "Ya Rasulullah, Hanzala has become a hypocrite." And the Prophet said, "How so?" He said, "Ya Rasulullah, when we're with you and you remind us of Jannah and you talk to us about Akhirah, you talk to us about everything pertaining to the hereafter, it increases our iman and our faith. When we leave your gathering and we go home and we spend time with our wives and our kids, then we laugh and we enjoy ourselves. We forget about what you were talking to us about. Our mindset and the way we were changes when we see our family." The Messenger then, alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, "Sa'atu wa sa'a, wa sa'a sa'a." Alhamdulillah, everything has its timing. Time that you spend with your family. The point is, when they saw slight discrepancy in themselves, slight difference, what would they do? They would run to the doctor of that time. And so sometimes you find a person will come up to you after their heart is died. But where were you when your heart was ill and not dead? When you saw some changes in you, what were you doing at that moment? Nah. The author then, rahimahullah, he says, فَصْلٌ فِي اسْتِحْبَابِ تَرْتِيلِ الْقُرْآنِ وَيَنْبَغِي أَنْ يُرَتِّلَ قِرَاءَتَهُ وَقَدِ اتَّفَقَ الْعُلَمَاءُ عَلَى اسْتِحْبَابِ التَّرْتِيلِ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا وَثَبَتَ عَنْ أُمِّ سَلَمَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا أَنَّهَا نَعَتَتْ قِرَاءَةَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قراءة مفسرة حرفا حرفا رواه أبو داود والترمذي والنسائي وقال الترمذي حديث حسن صحيح وعن معاوية بن قرة عن عبد الله بن مغفل رضي الله تعالى عنه قال رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يوم فتح مكة على ناقته يقرأ سورة الفتح فرجع في قراءته رواه البخاري ومسلم وعن ابن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال لأن أقرأ سورة أرتلها أحب إلي من أن أقرأ القرآن كله بغير ترتيل وعن مجاهد أنه سئل عن رجلين قرأ أحدهما البقرة وآل عمران والآخر البقرة وحدها وزمنها وركوعها وسجودها وجلوسهما سواء قال الذي قرأ البقرة وحدها أفضل وقد نهي عن الإفراط في الإسراع ويسمى الهد وثبت عن عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه أن رجلا قال له إني أقرأ المفصل في ركعة واحدة فقال عبد الله هذا كهذ الشعر إن أقواما يقرؤون القرآن لا يجاوز تراقيهم ولكن إذا وقع في القلب فرسخ فيه نفع رواه البخاري ومسلم وهذا لفظ مسلم في إحدى روايته قال العلماء الترتيل مستحب للتدبر ولغيره قالوا ولهذا يستحب الترتيل للعجمي الذي لا يفهم معنى لأن ذلك أقرب إلى التوقير والاحترام وأشد تأثيرا في القلب.
section, the reciter must recite aloud in a slow, pleasant tone, as agreed upon by the scholars, and Allah says, and recite the Qur'an in a slow, pleasant tone.
The author, rahimahullah, here he talks about the recitation of the Qur'an and reading the Qur'an with tartil. Tartil meaning a pleasant recitation in which a person observes the articulation of the letters with a beautiful voice. Naam.
It is authentically reported that Salama described the recitation of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as one that explained the meanings letter by letter. Abu Dawood, At-Tibyaan, and Nasa'i narrated that this hadith, and At-Tibyaan ruled it to be Hassan Sahih.
Who knows the name of Salama? What is the name of Salama? Hey, yeah. What's the name of Salama? Yeah? Yeah? You okay. Hinda was the name. Naam. Where is it? Ismuha Hind. Naam, her name is Hinda, radiallahu ta'ala anha. You see, if you don't know the name of the Prophet's wife, Salama, whose name you hear every day, is worrying, right? Sah? Are you with me, brothers? Very worrying. Yeah? Ramla itself is weak. Huh? That's the right one, yeah. Ayah? وعن معاوية بن قرة. So what Salama did was, she actually she described what it meant that the Prophet ﷺ recited the Qur'an harfan harfa. She actually read it. That the Prophet ﷺ's recitation was Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim Maliki Yawmiddin Iyaka Na'budu Wa Iyaka Nasta'een Ihdina As-Sirata Al-Mustaqeem Sirata Al-Ladhina An'amta Alayhim غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. That the Prophet would read word, sorry, ayah, ayah. None of this. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. The Prophet wouldn't do that. Plus, every single letter that the messenger read would be heard. Yeah? Every letter that the Prophet ﷺ said will be heard. One of the hardest letters to say because of the closeness of its makharij is kal'ihin. Ihin. The ayin and the ha coming out straight away together. Kal'ihnil manfush. Ihin. Ihin. Can you say ayin and ha at the same time? The Prophet, every letter would be heard. Not kal'ihin. Ihin. Huh? His hat would be big and it would come out correctly, and his ayn would come out correctly. Huh? And what makes the Qur'an nice to listen to and enjoy listening to is when the person's makharij is good. Sah? It's not the sound necessarily. The sound beautifies it. It's the cherry on the cake. But what really matters is that the person's makharij is on point. That is the beauty, when the person is saying every letter properly. Naam.
Muawiyah ibn Qurra narrated that Abdullah ibn Mughaffal, may Allah be pleased with them, said, I saw the Messenger of Allah, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, on the day Mecca was captured and riding his camel and reciting Surah Al-Fat in a slow and beautiful tone and repeating the verses. This is narrated by Bukhari and Muslim.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the day of Yawm al-Fath, he was on his riding beast, and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was reading Surah al-Fath. Inna fatahna laka fatham mubina. and the Prophet was reciting it, and he was going back on it again. Like he was reading it and then he was going back, reading it and going back. Alayhi salatu wa salam. Naam.
Mujahid was asked which of the following is better. Was two men, one who recited Surah Al-Baqarah and Ali al-Imran, or one reciting only Al-Baqarah?
Did you read Ibn Abbas? You jumped Ibn Abbas.
They ordered it differently in the book.
Oh, okay.
So after the Bukhari and Muslim narrated this hadith, Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, is reported to have said, I prefer reciting one chapter in a slow and beautiful tone reciting the whole Quran.
Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, what did he say? لَأَنْ أَقْرَأَ سُورَةً أُرَتِّلُهَا أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ أَنْ أَقْرَأَ الْقُرْآنَ كُلَّهُ بِغَيْرِ تَرْتِيلٍ. I prefer to read one surah, but I read it with diligence, and I read it slowly, and I read it properly. Tartil here means not the ones that you see the Egyptians today doing. Like it just goes, it's like, sometimes you feel like he went for coffee, comes back. The duration is so long, that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about Husari's recitation. Manshawi, the good ones, the one he reads nicely. Those recitation. That, for me to read a recitation like that, أحب is more beloved to me من أن أقرأ القرآن كله. Then need to read the whole of the Quran بغير ترتيل, without any ترتيل. I prefer reading the Quran one chapter, one surah with ترتيل is more beloved to me than bringing the whole Quran and reading it fast without any ترتيل. No.
Mujahid was asked which of the following to be better: two men, one who recited Surah Al-Baqarah and Ali Imran, or one reciting only Al-Baqarah, within the same amount of time standing, bowing, prostrating, and sitting. He replied, the one who recited only Al-Baqarah is the best one.
So two brothers praying together, but two sisters, they're praying together. One sister, she's reading in that stand only Baqarah. Whereas the other one, the other sister, but the other brother is reading what? His Baqarah and Ali Imran, and they do the ruku' at the same time. Because this person is reading Baqarah بِالتَأَنِّي وَالتَّرَوُّ, calmly, collectively, going over the verses, repeating it again, thinking, coming to the verses of Rahmah, asking Allah for forgiveness and asking from His virtue, coming to the verses of punishment, seeking refuge in Allah from the evil there is. This person is pondering, they recite with tartil and everything. This person, on the other hand, what are they doing? They're doing qira'ah, which is surah, is reading very fast, and they're going over the verses. We're going to see it. He's doing a qira'ah called qira'atu had. Had means what? We're going to see it soon, inshaAllah ta'ala. Is sardul qira'ati bi isra'. Is when the person reads the qira'ah with isra' and isti'jal, hastiness and speed and fastness. But they both do the ruku' at the same time. So their stand was the same. Which one's better? Even that though this one read more letters, and had more words that he read, letters that he read, this other one has been following what? Sunnah. So it's about quality, brothers, and not quantity. The Sahaba, they loved which one? They didn't want the number of letters that you read and how much calculation-wise that you got. They preferred the other one. The one who is reading with what? Calmness. So Mujahid ibn Jabrin preferred that the one who only read Surah Al-Baqarah, because he was reading it calmly, he was reading it collectively. Naam.
Going to extremes in reciting the Quran quickly is prohibited, and it is called
Hadd. So it's prohibited, anil ifrat fil isra', the person reading the Quran fast. What are they reading? مثل الذين عملوا التوراة ثم لم يحملوها كمثل الحمار يحمل أسفارا بئس مثل القوم الذين كذبوا بآيات الله والله لا يهدي القوم الظالمين. This is, it's incorrect. Are you with me? The person reading like that, it is prohibited. ويسمى الهد. This recitation is called what? الهد. Yeah.
It is narrated that a man came to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud saying, I recite the entire Mufassal. A Mufassal is a set portion of the Qur'an, the exact length of which is a matter that scholars have differed regarding in one rak'ah. Abdullah replied,
We already spoke about the Mufassal. The Mufassal, the strongest opinion is from Surah Qaf ila Surah An-Nas. That's Mufassal. That's the strongest opinion. Some dispute that they put Surah Al-Hujurat in there. And when we did the tafsir of Surah Qaf, we mentioned that it is what? We mentioned that it is what you call it, Allah Musta'an, from Surah Qaf. And that's the strongest opinion. So it starts from Surah Qaf ila Surah An-Nas. He read it all in what? One rak'ah. So what Abdullah ibn Mas'ud sensed from him here is that he read it fast. Yeah?
Abdullah replied, this is like the quick recitation of a poem.
He said, هَذَّنْ كَهَذِّ الشِّعْرِ. This is somebody who's trying to read a poetry very fast. Yeah?
There are those who recite the Qur'an, but it does not descend past their throats, meaning they read it without contemplation, and so it doesn't reach their hearts. Had it reached their hearts and become established in it, it would have truly benefited them.
Ibn Mas'ud, said, إِنَّ أَقْوَامَ يَقَرَؤُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. A group of people read the Qur'an. لَا يُجَاوِزُ تَرَاقِيهُمْ. It doesn't pass their collarbone. The Qur'an is on the mouth only. These are the Khawarij. Now, what's happened to the Khawarij? How have they become misguided? How have they become deviated? Their recitation of the Qur'an is مُجَرَّدِ الْأَلْفَاظِ. They just read it with their tongue. As for it's coming from the mouth, and entering into the heart and sinking into their heart is not there. So he said, وَلَكِنْ إِذَا وَقَعَ فِي الْقَلْبِ. But if the recitation falls into the person's heart, فَرَسَخَ فِيهِ, and then it grounds itself in the heart, meaning it settles in the heart, نَافَعَ. It what? It'll benefit you. Because the whole purpose of the Qur'an is what? تَدَبُّر, and pondering and contemplating. That's the relationship between the Qur'an and the... That's the relationship between the Qur'an and the heart. Naam.
This previous hadith is narrated by Al-Bukhari and Muslim, and this is the wording that is reported in one of Muslim's narrations. The scholars have stated that tartil is recommended for contemplating the Qur'an as well as other reasons. For this reason, it is recommended that the non-Arabs who do not understand the meanings of the Qur'an to recite with tartil, as this is closer to giving the Qur'an its due honor and respect, and more likely to have an effect on the heart.
Now Nawawi mentions a mas'ala latifa, powerful benefit, which is some people would say to you, but I don't even understand, so why would I have to read with tartil? Because you just said that the tartil, reading it with this type of recitation, you said that it's for pondering, right? Nawawi is saying to you, this is for pondering, and I am a foreigner. I can't ponder. I don't even know what the Qur'an is saying. I don't understand it. It's in another language. I don't speak Arabic. Does that make sense? So, I think I can read it faster, inshallah ta'ala, since I'm not going to ponder on it anyways. Sah? He says, as for the one who isn't an Arab, meaning he doesn't understand the Arabic language. Okay? Brothers, the one who doesn't understand the Arabic language, here he means, للعجمي الذي لا يفهم معناه, that doesn't understand its meaning, the Qur'an, he says he should also read with tartil. He should also read with الترتيل. Why? Number one, لأن ذلك أقرب إلى التوقير والاحترام. This is, you're honoring the Qur'an. You're what? You're honoring the Qur'an, which is something that you should do. The second thing is, وَأَشَدُّ تَأْثِيرًا فِي الْقَلْبِ, and it will have a great effect on the heart. It will have what? It will have a great effect on the individual's heart. It will affect the individual's heart. Where's Jwari's mom? Huh. He Yeah, she's troubling the people. Stop, tell her to stop it. No. فصل في استحباب التسبيح والاستعادة والسؤال في القراءة إذا مر بما يناسب ذلك ويستحب إذا مر بآية رحمتنا يسأل الله تعالى من فضله وإذا مر بآية عذابنا يستعيذ من الشر أو من العذاب ويقول اللهم إني أسألك العافية أو أسألك العافية من كل مكروه أو نحو ذلك وإذا مر بآية تنزيه لله سبحانه وتعالى نزه فقال سبحانه وتعالى أو تبارك وتعالى أو جلت عظمة ربنا فقد صح عن حذيفة بن اليمان رضي الله تعالى عنه ما قال صليت مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات ليل فافتتح البقرة فقلت يركع عند المئة ثم مضى فقلت يصلي بها في ركعة فمضى فقلت يركع بها ثم افتتح النساء فقرأها ثم افتتح آل عمران فقرأها يقرأ مترسلا إذا مر بآية فيها تسبيح سبح وإذا مر بآية سؤال سأل وإذا مر بتعوذ تعوذ رواه مسلم في صحيحه وكانت سورة النساء في ذلك الوقت مقدمة على آل عمران قال أصحابنا رحمهم الله ويستحب هذا السؤال والاستعادة والتسبيح لكل قارئ سواء كان في الصلاة أو خارجا منها قالوا ويستحب ذلك في الصلاة للإمام والمأمون والمنفرد لأنه دعاء فاستووا فيه كالتأمين عقب الفاتحة وهذا الذي ذكرناه من استحباب السؤال والاستعادة هو مذهب الشافعي وجماهير العلماء رحمهم الله وقال أبو حنيفة رحمه الله لا يستحب ذلك بل يكره في الصلاة والصواب قول الجمهور لما قدمناه قول الجماهير لما قدمناه جزاك الله خيرا.
This is also recommended for the reciter to ask Allah for His mercy whenever he recites a verse dealing with Allah's mercy and seek protection with Allah from evil and punishment whenever he recites a verse that deals with Allah's punishment or say, O Allah, I ask you for your deliverance or say, I ask you for deliverance from all evil or something similar to that.
The author, rahimahullah, he talks about exalting Allah, seeking refuge from Him, also asking Him when reciting the Qur'an in places that are befitting for it. For example, if you come across verses which speak about punishment and the hellfire, you seek refuge in Allah from it. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about Jannah and paradise and the khayr that are there, You ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Jannah, and you ask from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala that He bestows His mercy onto you. And He tells you the things that you should say. He said you should try to say, Allahumma inni as'aluka al-afiyah. Oh Allah, I ask for forgiveness. Or you say, as'aluka al-afiyah min kulli makruh, from every evil. Or you can say, if you go against a verse which you want to exalt Allah, you say, Subhanahu wa ta'ala, or you say Tabarak wa ta'ala, or you can say Jallat azamatu Rabbina. All of those are the terms which you use. Now he's going to give you the evidence that one is allowed to do that. What is the evidence that whilst you're reading the Quran and you're in the middle of the Salah that you can actually say these? He gives you the evidence. Hayya.
Whenever the reciter reads a verse that glorifies Allah, he should also stop and glorify Allah saying, Subhana wa ta'ala. Glorified is He and exalted. And Tabaraka wa ta'ala. Blessed is He and exalted. Or say, Jalat athamatu Rabbina. Glorified is the greatness of our Lord. Hudayfa ibn al-Yaman reports, I prayed with the Messenger of Allah, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, one night. And after reciting al-Fatiha, he began to recite Al-Baqarah. And so I thought to myself that he would bow upon reaching the 100th verse. When he passed that verse, I thought he would complete Al-Baqarah in the first rak'ah and then bow. But he continued and recited An-Nisa and then completed it, and then started Ali Imran and completed that. His recitation was regular and consistent, and whenever he recited a verse that glorified Allah, he would glorify him. And whenever he recited a verse that mentioned supplication, he would supplicate. And whenever he recited the verse that involved seeking refuge with Allah, he would seek refuge in him. Muslim narrated this hadith. At the time of this story, Surah An-Nisa came prior to Ali Imran in the order of the Quran.
We'll take a break inshallah ta'ala for 15 minutes, and then let's come back and we'll carry from there inshallah ta'ala.